y'all the faithful ones, but if they see you attend church when nothing else gets in the way, you know what they're going to grow up learning? You go to church when you can, but don't worry about the rest of it. But if they see that you put going to church, reading your Bible, praying, I don't care what it is, if they see that you do it no matter what, guess what? They'll grow up learning that they're supposed to do it no matter what. We as fathers must be consistent in training them, teaching and training them in righteousness. Train up a child in the way, train up a child in the way they should go. And when they're old, it's not that they'll have to come back to it. It'll be in them so much they'll never depart from it. Do you see how that works? You train them in that direction. Teaching and training are both very intentional activities. Both require time and commitment that must be invested in the lives of our children regularly. But the last ingredient, Father, is perhaps where most of us are likely to stumble and fall. I have many times. The third part of this triangle is leading. Leading is the idea of being out in front, of going before. Someone once said, I think it was a president, and I think it was the guy from Missouri, was from Kansas City. Who was the president from Truman? I think it was Truman, but don't hold me to this. But one of our presidents, I'm pretty sure, said this: if you think you are leading, look behind you. If no one is following, you are not leading. Got it? It's that simple. Leading requires getting out in front, as the old saying goes, putting your money where your mouth is. You know, Jesus severely chastised the Pharisees in his days because they called themselves spiritual leaders, but they weren't practicing what they preached. They weren't truly leading. Fathers, we need to be leading our children in righteousness by our own example. Leading comes by giving the example. They need to see us. Our kids need to see us reading our Bible. They don't need to just see our Bible laying beside our table or beside our chair on the table. They need to see us reading our Bible. They need to see us leading them to church, not following mom to church, but leading them to church. I am so thankful that I had a father who led us to church. Now, he was a preacher. He wasn't always a pastor, but he was a preacher. And so he wasn't always the pastor of the church. We just attended, but it was my dad. I knew who was leading us to church. We weren't going because mom was in there telling, hey, it's time to get up and go to church. It's because dad had already been up. He'd been on his knees. He'd been in the word, and he was ready to go to church. We need to see our love for God. They need to see our love for God in action. Whether it's our day-to-day lifestyle, our day-to-day activities, or even and especially in worship. Our children need to see us worshiping the Lord, demonstrating what worship is all about. I'm so thankful. I learned that it was all right for a man to cry because I watched my daddy bawl. Well, I shouldn't say bawl like a baby, but I've seen the tears run down my dad's face many times in church as he was worshiping. And I'm glad for that because I learned. I watched him, and I learned from that in my own life. They need to hear righteousness in our words. They need to see righteousness in our actions. They need to recognize or feel righteousness coming from our hearts. The bad part is the weeks, the months, even the years of being the right example can all be wiped out by one mistake. One mistake. That's why men, we have to learn to do one of the hardest things in the world for us as men. We have to learn to admit our failures. We've got to learn to apologize for our mistakes. I'll never forget when Jason, our middle child, our second son, I want to say he was fourth, fifth, sixth grade, probably more like fourth or fifth grade, may have been a little younger. But I was scolding, I think, all of the kids. They were right there. And I was pretty upset, pretty angry about something. I don't remember what it was. But he back-sassed me a little bit. And before I knew what I had done, I'd reached out and slapped him. He got the idea real quick, but it didn't take but just a few minutes before I realized, you know what? That was wrong. Because I didn't slap him in discipline. I slapped him in anger. I knew I had done wrong. So about 5 minutes later, I went and found him in his bedroom. I went and apologized to him and told him that I realized I had done wrong. Now, I can tell you today, because I've talked to him about it, he doesn't remember that incident at all, but I still do. And I think I'm not trying to say it and mean it like this, but I think I made points that day. I think there was some reality that came real in his life. But I knew I had blown it. I had absolutely blown it. I shouldn't have done what I did. Not that I shouldn't have slapped him necessarily, because I didn't hurt him. I didn't leave a mark. I didn't knock him across the room. I just reached out and slapped his mouth. Don't talk to me that way. But I didn't do it with the right attitude. We've got to learn how to apologize for our mistakes, to admit our failures, and to go back and right our wrongs. See, men, here's the fact. Leaders lead. And men, we've been called to lead our families. We've not been called to follow our wives. We've been called to lead our wives. Church, this is not simply a message for fathers and husbands today, though. We've all been given the urge in Scripture, the command, contend for the faith. In Elijah's day, God said enough is enough, and he sent Elijah forward and said, today it's time to take a stand. And Elijah contended for the truth. You know what that word contend means? It means to struggle or to resist or to oppose. You look at the prize fighter, the guy who's fighting for the heavyweight championship or whatever. What do they said? They're contending for the title. It's a fight. It's a struggle. It's something they have an opponent in this thing. Elijah's challenge to the people of God was, how long are you going to hesitate and waver between two opinions? It's time to quit riding the fence. Get on one side or the other. Our society today may not be struggling with false idols that sit on a stand and have a face and body to them, but we're still struggling with the same issues of sin and immorality in our society today. And it's time that we as Christian husbands and fathers, even all of us as Christians, begin to stand up and struggle, resist, oppose the lies and the worldly rhetoric that keeps coming at us and telling us that sin is okay. It's a lie that I want teenagers and adults to hear. It is a lie that says that sex outside of marriage is okay. That in reality, you can't keep from it. Your hormones are going and you're a teenager, you're a young man, a young woman. It's not okay. The Bible says it is sin, plain and simple. It was in Jesus' day, it was in mine, it still is today. Our society today is telling us that homosexuality is normal and good. Let me tell you, it's a lie. The Bible says it's an abomination before God. It is still sin today. Transgenderism, it's supposed to be something, hey, you just go through this. It's okay. It's acceptable. Children should be allowed to choose their sexual identity. I want to tell you, it's not what I'm saying. It's what the Word of God says. And that's what we've got to say. I'm talking about contending for the faith, and it starts in our own homes. These are lies contrary to the Word of God, and it's time that we contend, and contending requires a struggle. You know that Jesus Christ himself said these words? This is from Matthew chapter 10, verse 34. Listen, this is Jesus speaking. Jesus said, do not think that I came to bring peace on the earth. Jesus is the Prince of Peace, amen? But he says, I did not come to bring peace on the earth. I did not come to bring peace but a sword, for I came to set a man against his father and a daughter against her mother. and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be the members of his household. He who loves father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. He who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. He who does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. He who has found his life will lose it. He who has lost his life for my sake shall find it. Jesus says, I've come and I'm going to bring division, because you're going to have to take a choice where you're going to stand. We've got to contend for the faith. Now, I'm not here to say that our anger, our resentment should be against those who've been deceived. Think about it in Elijah's day. When Elijah took the people down to the Kidron Valley, who did he slaughter that day? He slaughtered the prophets who'd been leading the people in the wrong direction. To the people themselves, he extended mercy and grace because they'd been led astray. Church, husbands, fathers, we are the spiritual leaders. God is going to hold us accountable for how we're leading our families. We must contend for the gospel, for the truth. We must stand and declare what is right in our homes, first of all, but as well throughout our lives. We cannot compromise the truth in turn in an idea that we're going to make people happy. You know, that's a lot of times where we're at, and I'm guilty of it as much as anybody. I don't want to upset somebody. But let me ask you this. If somebody were on a road to destruction, would you care very much about if you upset them a little bit when you jumped out in front of them and said, stop, you can't go any farther. The bridge is out. The road is messed up. You can't get past here. You'll die. Would you care whether they got a little upset if they started honking their horn at you? No, you don't understand. The bridge is out. Now, eventually, you're going to have to let them make their own choice, yes. But I think most of us would do everything we could to stop them from death. Spiritually, that's our responsibility still today. Amen. And especially within our own homes. We've got to be the ones who take up the responsibility. Teach. Systematically educate. Take advantage of the teachable moments. We've got to teach. We've got to train with practice and discipline in their lives. We've got to lead, going before them, being an example in our words, in actions. Contend for the faith. Now, you may have heard me say those words at the beginning, contend for the faith, and you thought I was going to tell you to go out on the street corner somewhere and preach, or to get on your Facebook account and start sending out gospel messages. I'm talking about in your own home. Contend for the faith. Today is Father's Day. I want to thank you, every father who's here. As I said earlier, I think I'm preaching to the choir, and it's usually that situation. But today I would like to take advantage of the moment and to ask you not only to contend for the faith, but give me an opportunity to pray for you in your contending for the faith. Satan is out to destroy our families. He is out to destroy our families. God needs you to be the leader in your household. So men, I'm going to ask you to come. In a moment, you're going to get you'll be able to take a gift. And I know you've been chomping at the bits to get your gift. I know you just couldn't hardly wait. You've been going crazy over that this morning. But I'm going to ask you, men, if you will come and stand here across the front and allow me to pray for you this morning. Would you come right now? Cody, if you'd start that music, and then you come up here and join us as well. I'm not going to put you on the spot individually by any means, but men, I'd like to be able to pray for you today. Some of you have still got kids at home. Some of you are well beyond having kids at home, and you got grandkids. It's still a responsibility for you to stand and contend for the faith. Ladies, if you'd like to come, children that are here, if you'd like to come and stand behind your man, stand by your man, then I'm going to ask you to come and stand behind him and pray for him as well, as we just begin to pray this morning. Father, right now I thank you for these men. Father, these men of God, who as I look at them, I see them as being men who are faithful, who are here week after week, Lord, and I believe that they desire to contend for the faith. And Father, this morning I pray that you'd begin to instill in them a greater desire, Father, to stand strong in their home, to teach and to train and to lead their children, their grandchildren, Father. I pray that you give them boldness and courage, Father, when it's uncomfortable to take a stand, when the children seem to be tired of hearing the same lessons, but God, that you give them that courage and that boldness to stand. Father, we pray for your blessing today, your mighty blessing today upon each of them, your wisdom, Lord, upon their hearts and their minds. God, we pray that they would be not only leaders in their homes, but in their community, Father. God, those men and women that they come in contact with, give them courage to contend for the faith in their lives. God, today it's become unpopular to say things that are what we call conservative. But God, I pray that we would not be afraid, Lord, to stand up for what the Word of God tells. Maybe not what's politically correct, but what the Word of God tells us. Father, help us to be faithful and consistent day after day, we pray. Help us to make the tough decisions in our lives. Father, whether it's just for ourselves or whether it's for our entire family. Father, to be those men who will go before, who will lead, who will be the example, Father, before our families, Lord, before our church family, to say, I'm going to lead the way. Father, I thank you for these men and the other men of our church today. We pray your blessing down upon them today, your wisdom, your knowledge, your giftings, your callings. Father, may they be real in each man's life today. Father, make this day a blessed day with your family, a day of family, a day of love, and a day, Lord, just to be together. We love you, Father. Thank you for being a perfect Father, the Father who goes before us and leads us, who showed us what love was all about through Jesus Christ. We love you, we praise you, we exalt you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, the cups are all the same. The knives are all different. Pick what you want. There's some knives up here that are a little different from the others. So take your time. Pick out what you want. Get what you need. The wallet stuff is right there in the middle if you don't have one of those.
Was I there enough to make